Yeah. So, yeah, I would like to just say a little bit about this program to start with. Welcome to MondayFix Goa. And we're Das from Goa, and we aspire to build social capital through these programs. And today we're collaborating with HasGig. And this talk is about social media, and because it is simultaneously revealed and celebrated for its role in social movements and public discourses, it is as well, it's an enabler or a hindrance to the democratic engagement of voices. Today's speaker is Mr. Sandeep Khurana. He's a researcher on tech in the public sphere. And he will present two contemporary case studies on the role of social media in hashtag MeToIndia movement and hate speech. And mostly, this talk will include issues of civil society influencers, bots, misinformation, information control, surveillance, etc., and their roles in the broader social media structures. And today's moderator is Dr. Padmini Raimure. She's the founder of Design Beku, a collective that works to change and shift our approach to how we think about design and technology as processes of co-creation and participation that facilitates rather than dictates. And now I'd like Padmini to start the conversation.
Great. Hi. Thanks very much, Nilankur, for that introduction. It's a great pleasure to introduce Sandeep Khurana, whose work I admire, because I think he brings excellent kind of lens onto the way we think about social networks through processes of social network analysis, which he will talk about. Both, I think he kind of explicate on the technicalities as to how he undertakes this analysis, and then what it tells us about movements and about kind of phenomenon that unfolds on social networks. So Sandeep will be focusing on the Me Too movement as well as on hate speech on social platforms like Facebook and Twitter, and will be walking us through how he uses his analysis to explore how the dynamics of these unfold. He's a data scientist and a researcher. He is currently a research scholar at the Indian School of Business. Before that, he's an ex-army officer, and he completed his postgraduate degree from the Indian School of Business as well. Post that, he has experience managing large projects in the IT and technology sector, both in the US and in India. So yes, thank you very much, Sandeep, for being here, and we look forward to hearing about your work. The flow of the event is that Sandeep will talk for around 15, 20 minutes about the techniques that he uses for a social network analysis, and then we'll take a little break to kind of take audience questions. Audience questions, by the way, please feel free to either kind of input on Zoom or on YouTube, because we're streaming on YouTube live. And then he'll speak a little bit more specifically looking at case studies such as Me Too and hate speech. And then we'll take another round of questions. So thanks very much, Sandeep.
Thanks, Padmini, for that generous introduction. And let me start right away. Okay, so as Padmini just mentioned, I'll cover the talk today in these broad sections. Firstly, I'll lay the foundation in terms of both the technique of network analysis that we use to understand the social networks, and also in terms of some of the key research papers from the literature or the research background. With these two foundations being set, we'll dig into a couple of case studies, as the title of the talk is on both the hindrance side as well as the enabler. So I'll touch upon both diverse dimensions, one in terms of enabler for the social movements and the other how it hinders the discourse through the case study related to hate speech. So let's start right away with the basics of the network analysis. Primarily, any network is built on relationships. So It is same is true whether it is in the technology side, is a network of routers, or it is true for the social networks. The only difference could be that the two actors or two nodes or two persons, they are connected through a tie, and the nature of ties could differ, the nature of actors could differ, and it could be machines, it could be humans, but we are dealing with social networks. So in our case, one node to another node, or one person to another person, and whatever is the type of connection, that will be the tie. So specific to our example or our context, we are interested in the ties would mean, let's say, user one is friend of user two, or user one is, let's say, retweeting user two or liking a post of user two. So each of these are interaction types, or these are the relationship types. And that is how we gradually build the network, by adding more users, by adding more relationships, and gradually the network will start getting built up to a bigger size of many nodes or many users. Now, if you notice here, there is a thing, there is an arrow and not just a straight line, and which means that there is some directionality. So if user one is retweeting user two, that is not the same as user two retweeting user one. So there is that direction involved in the relationship type. But suppose we say user one and two are friends. Now in such case, there is no directionality. So a network or a relationship in the network can be undirected, can be directed, and it could also be bidirectional. So for example, if user one is following user two on Twitter, user two is following user one on Twitter, then that becomes a bidirectional relationship. Now, another interesting part is that we need not even have, say, direct relationships. So that is something known as a bipartite network, which is the figure at the bottom half of the slide, which primarily means that user one, let's say, is using hashtag 1, 2, 3, and 4, and user two is using hashtag 1, 2, and 4. Now, because they have three hashtags used in common, they have a certain relationship by virtue of having common hashtags. So those of us who are familiar with, or maybe most of us are familiar with, say, recommender engines, where let's say Amazon suggests those who like this book will like this, or those who use this page on a website, they will be expected to like another page. Now, those are based on these recommender engines, where these kind of relationships between users can be seen. All right. So we have the users connected directly, which could be directed or undirected relationship, and we also have users connected through a common shared, say, feature or shared relationship. So which means there could be not a direct relationship, but something indirect. So is this slide moving correctly now to the next one?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. So the next part is that we could not just have a relationship between two users. We could add more users. We could add more types of relationships. So for example, here I have the follow relationship, the retweet relationship, the favoriting or like relationship, and we have more users, and we have directional arrows flowing on both sides. And that's how the network will grow and become a big network. Now, another interesting dimension to the network analysis is that I don't just want to build the network, but I also want to use the visual features, so that when I look at the network, the story emerges from just the visual part of it. So visualization is an important part of the social network analysis. And there the tools that we use are, firstly, we would want to use color. So if we use different colors for different nodes, so for example, it could show the political affiliation, it could show the gender. So I have the users in orange dot or blue dot. Same way, I could have the user size depicting some attribute. So it could be that the number of followers is the size of the node. So if you see, the nodes have different sizes, the nodes have different colors, and I could also add more dimension. For example, I could use a square and a circle to indicate yet another attribute which is being modeled. Now, it is an art and a science, because if you put too many such parameters, again, you'll have to refer back and forth what means what and then interpret, and it may become too granular. So those are the trade-off decisions as a data scientist or as an art side of the visualization. But then it gives much more depth and flexibility to use these tools to build the kind of response to the hypothesis or to the research questions that you may be having. So same way, as I said about nodes, if you see here in terms of the ties also, we have those flexibilities. We have the flexibility of color, we have the flexibility of width. So width could indicate if A and B have more number of likes or more number of retweets. The color could indicate a particular relationship type. And same way, I could have a dotted line, dashed line, or a thick line, depending on the texture of the line also, I could convey certain parameters or attributes. And as you see, I could also put the labels. So these are important tools in terms of the building blocks to build a network. So it is just this short introduction, but there is a whole lot more which we will come to. But then this is what the... So is the full network visible? This is what the addition of nodes subsequently one by one that will lead to. So suddenly you find that from, let's say we had 5 nodes where everything seemed reasonable, what to look at and how to interpret. Suddenly we have, say, 5,000 or 10,000, or it may be, this is also a condensed network, but it could be even more than this. So now we have to kind of deal with some different tools to start reducing this network or condensing this or trying to filter it. So we can remove certain nodes. For that, we'll have to decide the criteria, because we don't want to remove any nodes which have an important, say, impact on or which have a significance to our research question or hypothesis. So one key tool which we use here is centrality measures, and there is a range of centrality measures. You would have heard of betweenness or the eigenvector centrality, clustering coefficient. So there are those closeness centrality. Those different definitions of centrality are there, based on which you can remove certain nodes, because you will otherwise have huge network of, say, even millions of nodes or lakhs of nodes, which will make it difficult to do the analysis. Same way, you can also do attribute selection. You can only filter on certain attributes. You can filter on the centrality measures, or you could filter on some attribute related to the ties and even the X or Y axis. You can filter out if the visually you can take the decision. Now, once these kind of requirements are there, the computational intensity of the analysis increases. So what does that mean? It means that the number of ties grows exponentially as the number of users grow. So it is straight that n minus 1 by 2, the number of combination possible between n players, the same combination, the same number of permutation combination will keep increasing exponentially as the number of players increase. So once the size of network is, say, lakhs of players and millions of ties, obviously the range, the memory required, the computational processing power required to process that data, or even to represent them visually, they all go an order of magnitude increase. Now, when these kind of requirements are there, then we have to have the tools which address this. And that's why this field has picked up, because not just the social networks came, say, 10, 20 years back, but also the tools related to analyzing them, whether it is the higher processing power, whether it is the cloud to give you the required space and algorithms and processing power on cloud, or it could be the GPUs and the technology to enable that, and all other big data stuff allow this. So there is one set of, say, the building blocks or the foundation which I wanted to kind of just get everyone on board as to what we do in social network analysis. The other side is the behavioral side or the social side or the qualitative side, where we get into how the social media is being used, because then I will merge both these streams to then come up to the case study and start seeing how both these allow us to demystify some of these social media phenomena. So a social media for social movements. Now, is it a boon? Is it a bane? It is a kind of evolution that we have seen when the early days of the Occupy Wall Street, Arab Spring, somewhere around, let's say, 2010-11, when the Arab Spring came and the Egypt revolution and the challenge to the government was posed. Now, these kind of movements gave a lot of promise, and that is almost a decade back, and that is where it became quite an important subject of research for the researchers, as well as researchers in both on the technology, information systems, information diffusion, and those part which are kind of technical or semi-technical, and also on the democracy, social movements, the freedom of expression, and the underprivileged communities. They all also found value in this kind of medium to leverage it for social movements. Now, the reason they found it useful, one, it was the aggregation of voice, because you can aggregate a large number of like-minded people with their vocal, with their voice on specific issue. It could be the political aggregation, it could be gender-based aggregation, it could be LGBTQ community, it could be the immigrants, which otherwise may not have voice. And there is a speed, a spontaneity, and flexibility. So you have the flexibility to log in and out of social media at will. You could participate at midnight, you could participate one day, not be there next day. You want to be there 24/7, and you want to do it from the flexibility of your home. So all those flexibility that came with it, there was a speed of response where you don't have to depend on some courier or messenger. There was an instantaneity, there was a spontaneity and speed involved with it. Now, along with all this convenience, there was also great reach. There is almost global reach. So as movement like, let's say, Me Too showed that once a certain cause strikes chord, that cause can have a reach which could be even global, and you would get the support across the globe. So that reach also worked in favor of social movements. And there were crumbling barriers of the kind where geography, nations, or even the barriers related to the access to privileged people or access, there was no barrier. There is no cost. So even those who have, so yes, there is a barrier of having internet access. But once you have it, there is no further barrier. So much so that even anonymity is assured and freedom of expression is assured. You could go to any extent in terms of once you cross the barrier, you could be your own, you could be defining your own persona, you could be defining your own choice of people you follow, choice of people you make friends with. And in that sense, it is democratized. It is an even platform. Now, the other thing is that from social movements on social media, gradually media started picking stories. So the media synergy is there, because of which it becomes attractive. Because initially, in the early years, it was just another channel. And gradually it became crowdsourcing of media news stories. It became both two-way relationship between media and social media. And that also gave a leverage to the social movements, where they could also extend to the real world and influence people who are not on social media. So that was the media synergy part. And then I distinguish the way social movements are organized in two different, categories. One is the movements which use social media for coordination, which primarily use its reach and use its, crumbling barriers or the convenience part and that. But then it is primarily an offline movement which will bring about the change. And it is primarily the social media being used only for coordination. The other kind of movements are the Me Too movement or the oil spill related environmental movement around the BP oil spill in Deep Horizon, Deep Water Horizon, or these kind of movements where the connections on social media itself is the movement. So the intensity of connections, the sheer, there is larger presence and driver is on the social media itself than on the ground. And yes, it will eventually have some physical component, or it may lead to a physical movement also. But the early action of the movement in Arab Spring was in the streets, then got coordinated better on the social media. And in the case of Me Too, the initial action, there was a big amount of interaction and activity on the social media, which had its effect on the physical world. So those were the things which worked for social media. But then this is gradual, say, shift. And if we can borrow from the song in Silsila, where we say, "Ye kahan aa gaye hum yun hi saath chalte chalte." So from there, the silsila of social media and the way we have progressed all together and seen how it has morphed into a different, say beast that we look at it today. So what is the kind of issues that the researchers and we as social media participants deal with today? Those are issues of misinformation, disinformation, fake news. I don't think the audience needs any introduction. But yes, say 8-10 years back, there were hardly any fact checker sites. We possibly did not even imagine, many of us, that there would be a need for such things. We did not have terms called post-truth. We did not have such kind of, say even the tools like bots and all, they were not there. So it was very difficult in those days. But yes, today it seems like the mainstream is this. It seems like the fact checkers hardly get any time, and they are unable to cope up with the volume that comes their way. So that is one aspect. Then there is another aspect of hate speech, which has, we'll go into more detail of this, but then the two big ones which we see on social media today, the misogyny and Islamophobia, both these are like huge enough for all the prominent research centers on either the social side or on the social media side. They both have specialized cells dedicated to kind of address these issues of misinformation, hate speech, and fake news. There is these tools which have been weaponized to subvert democracy, whether it is during elections or subversion of democracy, democratic debates. Now, earlier, it used to be manipulation of some surveys or manipulation through the mainstream media or some kind of manipulation in the offline world. Now, the social media has also become weaponized. And we'll see example of that and the process of that in the subsequent sections. So that is a grave danger, and because of which, again, there is a lot of research interest on the democratic fallout of the social media, the way it has evolved over time. There is the element of propaganda, primarily the extreme right-wing propaganda. Again, we'll see it in more detail. The bots, the trolls. So the difference between bots and trolls: bots are automated Twitter accounts which will post certain kind of content based on an algorithm or logic, and they may post, they may read, they may take certain actions. So those are the bots, and trolls are humans, but they spread negativity of n number of kinds, and there are a lot of there is a full vocabulary how the trolls operate or this. So most of us are familiar in terms of their action, but on the research side, there are sub-dimensions to these because that is the depth to which this whole machinery works. Now, this is all still yet just few dimensions, all that I have covered so far. There is on the platform side also, there are areas of concern. So there is a concern around the algorithmic opacity, which can have its own biases and which can have its own motives for the platform, which run contradictory to the user interest or contradictory to the interest of the democracies or social movements. So to give you a good example, if you are watching a certain YouTube video, so there is research by Zeynep Tufekci, where if you are seeing a YouTube video, you will be prompted through autoplay videos which are of same kind. And this has led to radicalization, because if someone is watching an extreme view on YouTube of a particular kind, YouTube knows by virtue of those who watch this will also like this, those kind of recommender engine algorithms, they will know that this person will also like this. Now, the effect of that is by the time your video finishes, you will be fed with another video with same theme. And 1, 2, 3, 4 videos, once you have seen, your biases get strengthened, your biases get deeper. So that leads to radicalization. And this, her research and the paper observation, they all became quite defining in terms of putting some controls and also to get this issue mainstream in terms of discussion. The relationship between the algorithms and the way it affects human behavior and the fallout on the negative side of the human behavior. So that is, again, yet another completely different dimension which is a subject of interest, that is the selectivism and the cause overload. So again, within this, these two are different. So selectivism is because people are kind of keyboard warriors and they are continuously clicking and tweeting almost 1, 2, 3, 500, even more tweets per day. So that is the level of activity on Twitter. Because of that, they are, which may be good as long as you follow it up with tangible action. That tangible action could mean filing RTI, FIR, PIL, or taking out a protest march, holding government accountable, or doing some action on the social side, helping people, or doing something to follow up on what Twitter affords as a features or to help build the social movement or to serve a certain cause. But then if it doesn't translate to that, it actually saps you of all the energy and deprives you of that opportunity to actually do something meaningful. So that is the charge, and it is true to some extent, or at least with a few people, where they are more keyboard warriors and selectivists rather than activists anymore. So that is one thing. The other is there is a cause overload, and there is a phenomenon known as hashtag burnout or activist burnout, where people who are into these kind of social causes, they have too many causes to deal with, because there is a daily outrage, there is a daily n number of hashtags to deal with, there are daily n number of causes, and you can't follow up those causes to conclusion. So as a result, it is just about, like, you are again leading to selectivism, and you are again just contributing to the overall noise and overall volume. But then who is following it? Who is following it up with tangible action? Because of the cause overload, that doesn't happen. And there is a prioritization which people do mentally or cognitively, and then try to address only the top of the mind things. And there is yet another dimension of surveillance control and the representativeness in terms of, are the people online representative of the entire country? So in a country like India, where the digital penetration, literacy, the adoption of social media is itself less, there is that question of representativeness of the media. And there is also the state intervention, that is yet another dimension of serious academic research, as well as concern amongst the social activists and the community related to the surveillance, control, and stifling of voice when it comes to use of social media for social causes. So there is a lot on this slide, and each is a different dimension, but I'm sure we are able to appreciate that there are so many forces then at work here, which cause us to give it the due importance. It is almost like our whole democracy has very deep connection today with the use of social media. And I have picked up very, very seminal 4 or 5 papers, which will kind of set the context for the next part. And these will give you the background as to what is happening there. So this paper is a very prominent paper in information diffusion and the information propagation on social media. And the authors Vasavi and the senior author Sinan Aral, they both have given us very great insights through a huge amount of, say, a very deliberate exercise which they did here. So in this paper, what they did was that they took about 126,000 stories from fact checker sites, which included both stories which turned out to be fact or a true story, those which turned out to be fake news. Now, using these, what they did further was that they tracked these stories on Twitter, collecting 4.5 million tweets from 3 million different people around these 126,000 stories which had this fact checker site. And they also did this collection of stories from multiple fact checker sites and also did inter fact checker reliability check to see that there is no bias within the fact checkers, and those kind of robustness checks were done by the researchers. Now, research concern? Just pay little attention to the figure on the right, and the topmost figure there is on the x-axis. We have the time, which primarily shows how the tweet is progressing. Just a second. Okay, so we have the tweet, which is originating at the left on top, which shows the Twitter symbol. And then there are retweets. So you see the retweet symbols down the time. Time goes from t is equal to zero on left to t is equal to infinity on the right. And as people keep retweeting, so there are different people retweeting and then different retweets getting retweeted. And that is how this information propagation, these people track. Now, this has multiple dimensions to it. So one dimension is depth. So depth means that if it is a retweet of a retweet of a retweet, now that is a depth of 3. So ultimate depth of a particular tweet which has got retweeted to retweet to retweet, now that has a depth of 3. It could also mean the size, which means that tweets and retweets all combined starting from an original tweet. In this case, if you see, there are total of 7 retweets and 1 original tweet. So that gives the second graph, which is the size, which is the total number of people who are tweeting or retweeting this. So that is the size. And the breadth is, if I cut across vertically, that at any point when I cut across, how many branches are there? So in those branches term, it is that I have, say, 4 branches, 3 branches, 2 branches, and whatever are the max number of branches, I try to map that out. So how this is progressing, I can get that also. Now, and then there is a definition of structural virality, which is a measure the authors involved, which was around the burst factor, that how suddenly a thing can go viral, and then if there are bursts around the tweet, then that will give it a high structural virality because it is going viral due to inherent nature of the content. Now, what they found is very interesting. So regardless of the wide range of the domains, they found that falsehood diffuse significantly farther, faster, deeper, and more broadly. And I just explained what does the farther, deeper, and all these means. So which is kind of insightful because it is a very large scale study, and that gives us the statistical robustness to kind of agree with the authors on this. The second thing is that in terms of politics, when the false news is related to politics, then the effect is even more pronounced. So effect is even more pronounced means that the difference between true and false stories in terms of the difference of depth or difference of the breadth or difference of the size, these all are much wider. The next thing is the false news. So the authors did very interesting thing that once they found these kind of insights, they said, okay, let's see what drives this. So let's get into the content. Let's see what is in those false tweets or false stories, which gives them a higher virality or a higher breadth, depth, size. And so they found that the false news is more novel. More novel means this is something new, something which is kind of outraging us, something which we find difficult to believe, something which is kind of not imaginable by us. Now, if those kind of news come, we are like, our mental judgment is, oh, this may be something which my followers or others whom with whom I share it with, they may want to know, because this is something which nobody will know, because I also don't know. So because of the novelty factor, they spread it more. But along with the novelty, they also studied the emotion dimension of the content. So they classified the all the tweets or the content related to the false news on emotional parameters of fear, disgust, surprise, anticipation, sadness, joy. So there are those 9 factor emotional sub-dimensions along which they classified these stories, and they found that false stories had preponderance of fear, disgust, and surprise. So those were the emotions invoked in the replies to the tweets related to these false stories. So I'll just pause here and then take some questions before moving on to the next set of research papers.
Hi. Yeah, thank you so much. That's really fascinating. And I think there's a lot of material that you've covered there. But one question that I kind of was wondering about is, what are the limitations of network analysis? As in, you know, we do know that, say, social platforms, say Twitter, for example, don't allow, you know, kind of multiple binning of APIs, etc. And also, like, how would these techniques, like, how do they account for bad players, like, you know, say bots or, you know, IT cells or certain parties? And also, how well does this work with non-English languages? So if you could just maybe say a little bit about those questions, that would be great. Thanks.
Okay. So very relevant question. And I would say, again, the question itself has so many dimensions and the levers around which the platforms and those who want to abuse the platform to manipulate. So because of that, they get a certain advantage. So yes, to answer some of these issues, the platform has a vested interest and they have to make trade-off decisions. One side, they have to be compliant with the law and the morality and the upholding democracy or those kind of universal values. The other side is they have the vested interest of having more eyeballs, vested interest of having their advertisers on board, the vested interest of allowing more users, because of that they allow anonymity, and that anonymity is then misused. So the platforms have that trade-off decisions. They don't take it as an absolute decision, which say a regulator would take, or which say a fair person would take, that something which is hate speech should be very easy to kind of then take remedial action. So one is the platform's vested interest. The second part is the algorithms are opaque. So even the platforms at times, they design it with good intent, but there are unintended consequences. Like we know about how the STEM had a bias based on gender, because the STEM ads were shown to Google users who were male, whereas they were intended to be shown to women audience. So there are unintended consequences, because the algorithm will maximize the target that is given in the original design. Now, if they have to maximize eyeballs, they don't care it goes to the exact segment to which you don't want it to go. You want to popularize STEM to women, but you end up showing it where you get more clicks, and you will maximize clicks. So the algorithms, there is a problem. Now, same way on the bots, there are ways to detect. There was, in fact, a viral story where somebody used techniques to identify the bots, which is that your @DP and then 0 followers and this. And then he removed almost 1.5 lakh bots by within the compliance to Twitter policy by just complaining against those. And the bots could not respond back because they are eventually bots. So if he could say these 4 reasons and then file complaints, and he also automated that, was he also can't do that for, or he or she, whoever the anonymous the hacker. So it is kind of that bots are also, the platforms can also do it, and they can also reduce that volume. But there are platform interests, there are vested political interests, because of which these things do not get addressed that easily. Now, coming to the other thing which you said about language. Now, increasingly, we are using AI, and it does simplify our work, and I'll show the difference in the results, what AI gives and what the human intervention gives. Definitely human intervention is much more accurate, and AI is much more faster and good for volume. So we have to use combination of both. So the way it works is, using AI, I classify it into red, orange, green. So something is purely, let's say, misogynistic, and that will go into clear red. Something which is purely, clearly not hate speech, and there is no negative emotion involved, it will easily go into green. Now, there is that middle chunk on which I may want to do some human intervention as a double check, and then try to qualify that and use it for research. And then using that, I come to a balance between both, because I need to cover a sizable chunk to be statistically relevant, and also not spend disproportionate time just manually reading each of the tweets. But when it comes to Indian languages, use of emojis, use of sarcasm, use of dog whistle, indirect slurs and pejoratives, and there is an example. In hate speech, I'll cover this in much more detail. So those are the issues which are tricky. There is also, people are using videos, people are using images and memes, because of which we have to also up our game in terms of research. So in my, data interpretation, I convert the images into text, or I convert the images by reading text from that, or by interpreting the image by using AI to then draw some inferences based on that. It is kind of becoming more difficult for both sides, because they have to generate content, and they are using good animation or videos and images. And same way, to decode that on our research side also, we have to then use more sophisticated tools to do that. So it is a cat and mouse game. It is never conclusive, and there is always just a probabilistic ratio that, okay, I could get 60% accuracy, 70% accuracy, which does give a defining decision that, okay, directionally, this is what the statistical weight of evidence is. But if you want a conclusive, say, 100% accuracy, that is always a mirage we are chasing.
We have a question from a viewer. Nalini Bharutula is asking whether there's a cause-based analysis around the interplay of social media and offline. So basically, you know, what you were saying, that, you know, sometimes we find that
one paper I have to present will cover that. So just that question. The fourth paper, this is the first one I discussed. The fourth one will cover this.
Okay, great. Then, please carry on. Thank you.
Okay, so this was all right. So let's move to another dimension related to the social media research. Now, this is research from the Oxford Computational Propaganda Research Center. They have a huge funding to study this phenomenon, not just in one medium or one country, but almost across the world and across the medium. And the findings are very revealing. So the researchers there, Bradshaw and Howard, they have this report on the Global Organization of Social Media Disinformation campaign, which they initially did in 2017. There were 28 countries. And the report has more details, which platforms, what kind of techniques they are using. Are they using bots? Are they using private parties? Are they using some kind of, propaganda machinery? Is it influencers? So what way they are using the platform, which platform, those details are there. But the interesting thing is, because of their 2017 report, they found that it is not just reducing, but rather going the opposite direction and increasing. So they did a same report with even more detail in 2018. And guess what? The number of countries went up from 28 to 48, and then in 2019 to 70. So this figure I quote is from 2019 report, and the link is also there to share. And what this found was that about 70 countries have varied degrees of organized social media manipulation. So if you see the dark blue colors in the globe global map on the left bottom, that is what indicates, the dark color indicates some kind of social media manipulation going on there. So it's in increasing number of countries. There are state actors, influencers, bots, private companies, all in different countries in different measure are doing all this. And then there is also the finding that they have is that there is not just, okay, right wing is using it. There is a lot of misinformation which is part of the propaganda, and that's where they call it a right wing propaganda. And the other reason to call it propaganda is wherever the authoritarian regimes are there these patterns are more significant or defining, the patterns of information control, surveillance, censorship, threats of violence. So they do good amount of data collection in terms of what is there on social media, and they have a team of researchers. They will also collect for all countries. They will also collect news items. They will do the content analysis and then do various kind of other qualitative and also speak to the journalists and experts to get a understanding. Now, there are three distinct ways which they find, and there are more findings for those interested who can see this. And there are a lot of reports on their site related to this whole phenomena of computational propaganda, which is another term for what we have been speaking so far. So the ways this takes place is suppression of human rights, discrediting the opposition, and drowning out the dissent, or creating so much noise that the signal or the democratic voice is drowned. So this is another research which I wanted to share, and needless to say, I don't think anyone is surprised that out of the 70, India is there. And there are a lot of dimensions on which India is finding the ignominy of being included in this report. So the third research I want to share is shifting from this macro to micro level. Now, this was again an interesting and very insightful research from Soma Basu. She did this research on WhatsApp groups. So she became member of 140 pro-BJP groups on the WhatsApp in the build-up to the Lok Sabha elections last year. And 4 months, she collected all the messages that came to those groups to set up the appropriate control group. She joined also 80 pro-Congress WhatsApp groups and also different other parties which were active on social media, their groups as well. So there are public WhatsApp groups which you can join, and there are also the groups were promoted by the parties. So whatever different links, handles, and there are technical techniques through which you can collect all this data. Now, after getting these 60,000 messages, she started doing the analysis of the content. And there were three distinct streams of messaging what she found. But the prominent finding here is there were about 1/4 of messages which were hate speech. And again, as I said about the first research, because it is a sizable sample size and there are these official groups, there are also 60,000 messages. It is robustness is checked through the control groups and the other parties' content. And it is the analysis of the content manually. So there is a team of researchers who will flag the content for whether it contains. So it is much more robust that way. So again, this is another indication at the micro level how these hate speech or the social media manipulation, these play out. Now, coming to the question that was asked, is the hate spillover to real world, this slide visible? Okay. So, is the slide visible, the change slide?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So yes. There was a question asked that is there a research connecting the online social media abuse, propaganda or hate to the real world? Now, again, this is a very seminal paper and it is such a detailed paper that even I don't have the required statistical economic kind of background to study each of the econometric and statistical robustness checks these authors have done. It is almost a 80-82 page research paper. This is set in Germany, the German right-wing party. So what the research has done, that is of interest to us. So what they did was that they tried to map the anti-refugee sentiment on Facebook to the actual violent crimes against refugees in municipality level. So they even went to the extent of including all the controls that we can think of. So a very interesting thing which I found in this paper was that if there was an internet outage or Facebook outage, then it fully undoes the correlation between social media and hate crime. So let's say in municipalities where people are posting high number of hate messages and suddenly there is no internet for 3 days due to the authorities blocking it, technical outage, whatever reasons, then all the blockage period, the hate crimes or the crimes in the physical world, they did not show that correlation. But in the other periods when the Facebook posts are there, there is that correlation. So internet outages were taken, the vote shares for this party in that particular municipality, those were taken, number of internet domains, the demographics, the party membership, do the party have offices in that area, does the party have Facebook pages for that municipality, dedicated pages, how many posts they are putting, n number of such parameters are there. And that's where this paper capturing the data from 2015-16 with this amount of robust research could get published sometime in 2019. So there is a deep, those who are interested should definitely see this paper, but this is very widely cited and it is one of the few papers, because this requires deep effort to show the link between social media and actual hate crime in the real world. So if you see the graph, it shows that wherever there is high Facebook usage, the hate crimes and the post, they show a near vertical or there is a steep rise in the hate crime. But wherever the Facebook usage is low, the graph is pretty much like very low slope. So it is a kind of research which we find useful to the kind of subject we are discussing. So now there are fundamental differences the way the three platforms which we are having the maximum membership of and which is causing the maximum concern. These three platforms, the way they are weaponized or the way they are being used, misused or manipulated. So I'll just touch upon a couple of points due to paucity of time, but if there is a query on a specific point, we can discuss that. There is one fundamental difference is between the closed and the open nature of the platform. So if you see Twitter, it is largely open. You have the flexibility of keeping your Twitter account closed, but it is very rare. So it is open, and that's where the different dynamics work on Twitter. WhatsApp is largely closed. So again, WhatsApp also has public groups, but then it is largely closed, and which defines then the nature of membership. We are largely connected to our friends and family. There is also a distinct feature of WhatsApp related to its mobile phone link. Yes, there is mobile phone link possible in Facebook, Twitter also, but in WhatsApp it is near 100%. So that gives it a different dimension related to profiling. Because if you have seen the cases during the election buildup between TDP TRS and the electoral SRDP data leakage and the app which was built to do the profiling. So these mobile phone linked databases are obtained and then based on that segmentation done, and that segmentation is used to create WhatsApp groups. And membership of WhatsApp groups are then, members of WhatsApp groups are then given different messages based on that segment. So it's already happening. It is no longer that It is in the realm of possibility because we have seen it in 2019 election. It was a subject of police case, complaints, political battle, and it had eventually died like most controversies. But then there was a private party involved which built up these segmentation and profiling databases. So same way Facebook, I don't have to tell much about the way Facebook did profiling. There is that Cambridge Analytica scandal where all the details are available, how this whole thing was manipulated. In Twitter, the other thing is related to the anonymity, which gives the whole dimension of hate, and hate also on Facebook, because Facebook also allows anonymous accounts easily. WhatsApp doesn't allow anonymous account, but it is closed. So if you see, all three have those kind of, some feature or the other, using which they are able to weaponize the platform and create some kind of hate or use it for weaponization of hate. So let's quickly jump to the next section. And I'll just pause here if there is any quick question, because there is a lot to cover and I will not be able to revisit these research papers once we get into the cases.
Yeah, hi. So I think the earlier question was actually also asking about the relationship between kind of social movements and mobilization online, and whether there's any kind of cause analysis to demonstrate that, you know, some forms of mobilization on social networks work better in order to support offline movements. So is there any kind of relationship, or is it, you know, fairly random, you know, kind of like what kind of social movements manage to succeed on the back of social media activity?
So again, good question, because as researchers, almost every time we do research on social media, we do give this a thought that the spillover to the real world, and that is where the rubber meets the road, that is where the governments really take notice. Otherwise, it may end up being noise. But the same way, like I showed the German paper and went into detail to show how this requires much more data collection, robustness check. Unless there is a clear paper which does this mobilization, does answer this hypothesis related to the mobilization question, it is very difficult to say how it is happening. Yes, there is a research, body of research, which talks of collective action and connective action. Primarily what that means is that in one set of movements, the social media is used to coordinate, and the movement actions are largely offline. The other set is that the connective action, where the movement is due to the interrelationships, dependencies or interactions, and the connections on social media, and that gives it the intensity and the weight. And the offline component could be just resulting in some kind of individual actions rather than mass protest or those kind of things. And there could be in case of Me Too, I see components of both, where the movement morphs from one kind of mobilization or connections to another kind of collective action. So there is this different ways social media is used, but I don't know of a research paper which will clearly address the spillover of online social media, social movement to an offline, activity in terms of intensity or other details of the offline activity to then do the robustness checks.
Thank you. I think we have around 15 minutes left, so I'll let you finish off and we have a few more questions after.
Okay. So my first case study is around the Me Too India, which was largely a very heavy presence on the social media. Primarily, it was Twitter based, and a lot of features of the movement, they are of interest, because there aren't too many social movements which leverage social media and which have a context very close to our country and to our society. So the features of this which generate interest, one, there was the presence of state and non-state actors. So there is the National Commission of Women, there are those other feminists and actors, but then the movement wasn't really driven by these formal or organizational bodies. It was driven largely by influencers. It was driven largely spontaneously, and no one would have predicted that on this date that this movement will take root and then it will suddenly go viral and it will kind of dominate everything else and become the trending topic for almost 4 or 5 weeks. So this is the period in September, October when Tanushree Dutta did the revelations, and then it followed up with a lot of women empathizing with the, even men, empathizing with the cause, empathizing with the failure of due process, with the reason to raise a collective voice and bring about change and all those issues. So it is of interest from that point of view. There is also how Twitter had those features and affordances because of which this could become the battleground. Twitter could become the battleground. To give you some examples, Twitter had introduced just about a year back or so the feature of threads, which was very popularly used by the complainants and victims to out their story. Twitter also has the feature of the DM, direct message, and the public tweet, and there were a lot of people who wanted anonymity, but there was also the concern on part of the influencers that they did not want fake stories, or they did not want any fake charges which will undermine the movement. So they did that important work of taking the messages through the DM, verifying, and then putting them out anonymously. So it could provide those features where through the mix of both these kind of features, they could provide anonymity, they could build trust, and they could also kind of provide the reach. So all this led to empowerment. There is also interesting dimension, which in our research, we saw the professional cross-section. So there were journalists, there were authors and writers, there were people from the music world. Within music world, there were people from the South Indian music film industry. There were people from the Bollywood or the Mumbai film industry. There were people from the professional or the corporate world who all came out in support of the movement and naming people or coming up with their stories on the particular injustice that happened to them. So there was a wide professional cross-section, and when we see the way these interactions evolved over time and connections evolved, there were interesting insights around these dimensions. And in terms of the outcomes, it is not for me to comment, and that is also not my area of research expertise, because I believe it is still a movement in progress, and there are areas to feel there is a gain and there is a change in mindset, especially in urban areas, corporates, where there is a growing importance given to the posh communities. There is a growing importance of understanding the nature of due process or the weaknesses of that, trying to address that. There may be also concerns around the defamation cases, where that's where I call it a mixed bag. We don't know whether that is a good thing, bad thing, because it has a chilling effect, which means the people are discouraged because of the deterrent of having to fight these battles and all. So there are multiple dimensions related to the gender justice, which I see this more as a prism of information diffusion, social media, but there are those experts like Padmini or others who may have those insights to add as to what is at play here over time. So due to the confidentiality involved, I have blocked out certain names, but this is the sisterhood network which is kind of driving the Me Too movement during that period of about 5 weeks. Now, something which is very obvious here is that there is heavy duty action between, say, about half a dozen influencers. So these are the people who are primarily connecting everything to everything and retweeting people and replying to people or coordinating activities, outing these stories, replying to journalists, or doing all sort of the heavy lifting. So So it is these kind of, say, results that make the social network analysis very exciting, because these insights kind of really look at you. They really speak for themselves through the visualization, and you can't really you don't really need to dig into the numbers or dig into the individual names or the kind of other things. So this was the primary insight, but then this was not our whole universe. Even this slide is not the whole universe. I can only pack in as much as slide can show, without kind of robbing you of the interpretability of the slide. So while that was the influencers at the top level, the known names and the names on which we had good amount of detail to collect. For example, there we had the celebrities, we had the influencers who were heavy on the activity only during the Me Too movement. We had the people who were feminists and who had active organizational roles, maybe chairperson of National Commission of Women. There were victims, there were complainants. So all those people were part of the universe that we had. This is a much larger universe of people who contributed. But again, as you see, the interactions are also that much wider. So when I go from the set of about 100 odd top influencers to the larger world, here again, the action is quite intense during that period of the movement. So this is covering about 69 trending topics, and they were in the form of various hashtags, and we collected data around that and analyzed that to come up with these insights. And there are more. If I go to the micro level, so these are the top 10 influencers. So there is a spectrum of, say, 10,000 people, there is a spectrum of 1,000 or 100, and then there is only top 10. So if you see this, it is of interest. So the left one is on the replies, who is replying to whom, and the right one is on the retweets. What is of interest in the replies is that there is a positive and negative sentiment to replies. There is a thickness of arrows which shows that who is interacting more with each other. So the arrows which are thick, arrows which are bi-directional, and arrows which are pink are positive sentiment or solidarity or support. A green is kind of disagreement. There were areas of disagreement within the movement on certain cases where within the top 10 also they had disagreements. So which is kind of interesting and insightful that there were filters and checks and balances within the top influencers to kind of not take blind decisions on the cases. On the right side, we have the retweets. Again, the interesting thing here also is the high degree of clustering. So top 10, almost everyone is interacting with everyone, and this reflects in the centrality measure or the clustering coefficient measures. These all 8-10 people, they are very thickly interacting with each other. So there are no silos. And on the topic of silos, we see some differences over time. So those are like things of interest. And what we also show through the colored nodes is what kind of nodes are these people. So there is a victim, there is the victim's spouse who is lending his weight, there is a journalist, there is a Me Too influencer, there is a celebrity. So those kind of insights, and there is also visualizations where we modeled these based on the profession. So there is the music world, there is the movie world, there are journalists, there are others. So how they interact with each other, there are insights which are related to the to those. So this is another last visualization on this use case, this case study, where we show, I discussed about the bipartite networks where people may not have something directly in common, but they may be having shared hashtags. So the blue color is indication of high intensity. The orange color is indication of low intensity, and there is the full spectrum in between. So in this case, the blue color in the center indicates that there is a high degree of common hashtags between the top 20-30 people who are in the middle of the movement. Again, these names I have to kind of keep confidential, but these are the same people who are there as part of the influencer network and who are doing this sharing of hashtags and driving the movement forward. So I pause here for quick question, or if Padmini suggests I go through this also and take questions at the end, it's...
I think we have one question, which is about whether there is any kind of papers or publications about the duplication of fake false news or fake news across platforms. So, you know, whether the same kind of fake news, you know, moves from Twitter, then converges onto WhatsApp and so on and so forth, and that's snowballing. Is there kind of any research or insights into that that has been published?
Okay, so you are saying the same kind of fake news being detected on Twitter as well as WhatsApp?
Yes, so basically fake news, like how it can travel from, you know, platform to platform, or as we've also seen, say television news, you know, a clip kind of moving from, you know, one platform to another, so that kind of convergence.
So again, I don't know of such a research, and the reasons for that are that Twitter is much easier to obtain data, but WhatsApp, the groups are not that easy. That's where I included that research, precisely because it is one of the very few researches which came out of, and there is like she had that kind of foresight as a researcher to know that during the election campaign this will happen, and then collected data. But to answer the question precisely, on both the dimensions, whether the TV channels or the media, in fact I discussed this with one of the fact checker site CEOs, that if somebody could track the media for their news items in terms of how much is Islamophobic, how much is hate speech, how much is driven against the political opposition or whatever parameters, then that quantification could help drive robustness in the... So someone has to physically do that, which is much more difficult. Twitter is also difficult, but it is technically like possible once you have the algorithms or the APIs and all that understood. It is relatively easy. But both WhatsApp, because of the closed nature, and media, because of the manual effort required to do the recordings, manually interpret, because AI will fail there. It is much more to deal with. And there is a lot of visual audio content, so it is to be interpreted. I don't know of such a research, but it will be useful to kind of have such a research. Because that will kind of nail it. Right now it is, like that German research became popular because of the same reason, but it is requiring some data collection to then come to the next question.
Sure. And a very quick question is that, is this data also mapped regionally and geographically?
So the region or geography we do as part of robustness checks, because many people will not reveal the location. The Twitter features allow you that as a privacy thing. So when you collect data, people may say somewhere in the sky, or so they'll just put some random location. So it is as a robustness check, some people would reveal, and that's, let's say, about 30-35% in my experience, about that many people will reveal it accurately. So if we use that as a robustness check, yes, but it is not conclusive. So a lot many times people will use IP address or something. This fact checkers have much more detail on this, on how accurate it is in terms of location or what workarounds they have to collect. But in our case, we didn't get into that part. Yes, we did collect hashtags or the data related to hashtags which were viral in India only. And then we do filter out the hashtags or which are like say global in nature. So like say Me Too. Me Too alone is not defining of India only. So if I'm studying Me Too India, then I have to discount those and look at Me Too India and use some other combinations to filter out. But otherwise, location is, again, not truthfully revealed on social media to kind of be conclusive on the large scale.
Thank you. Yes, please go.
So the next one is on hate speech. Again, it is a huge topic, and even I was surprised on the types of hate speech and the amount of flagging of hate speech into different types. And even within this, like on sexism or gender, this thing, there are again another 5 subtypes on how the misogyny is played out in 5 different subcategories. And for clickbait, there are other categories on bots or this. So there are n number of the n number of such say classes or bucketing, and there are agencies, paid, unpaid research algorithms which do this kind of flagging, and which is what we use for research, starting from very simple word search to getting into AI techniques to get more traction. But again, as I said earlier also, it is a cat and mouse game, and it is a like mirage which we keep chasing. So it is there are reasons for that. So I'll come to some more insights as we proceed. So there is a larger, say, problem of hate speech, which is at a strategic level. It is about the narrative setting, whether it is in elections, whether it is in day-to-day. The way weaponization of platforms has happened is to set the narrative, which could be to distract from a real issue and set the minds on some dummy issue, or it could be to set the narrative in the direction which the manipulator wants. And those are the kind of things which lead to the abuse or computational propaganda. How it happens is that there is that innocuous looking dog whistle, which means there is an indirect reference to something which somebody can disown, and which is kind of under the radar, but then it sends this signal to the dog. Or the way dog whistle works is the whistle is understood by the dog, which will bite the person. And if you come and catch me that why did you whistle the dog, you can't tell me that I whistled the dog to bite you. So I whistled the dog in a coded message. The dog came and bit you because I and dog have an understanding, but you can't catch me legally because you can't say the whistle means this. So that is how the manipulators, whether it is Trump, whether it is the other leaders here, whether it is the social media influencer, they will not be direct and they will use dog whistle. Now this dog whistle gets amplified using noise in an echo chamber, where this amplification, detailing, and further details will be added to this dog whistle to make it more obvious. That leads to a velocity and volume, and velocity and volume are the parameters on which Twitter adds it to the trends. The reason something trends gives it even more amplification, because once something is on trending topic, you and I will go and click and watch it, which gives more eyeballs. We may react, reply, retweet. So because of that, there is even more amplification. Increasingly, as I said, media spillover, there is two-way spillover from social media to media and media back to social media, because there is something which is trending on social media. For example, if Me Too India, Tanushree Datta, this media may not be interested, but because the influencers made it count by trending it on social media, the spillover on media is there. They were forced to cover that story. So same way, there are other many episodes where because something is very prominent on social media, it will get covered by media. Because of that media spillover, there are other social media spillover. Because media covers it, media starts getting retweets. So in my networks, I find a lot of media embedded in specific networks because the media covers only a specific message. So because of that, they become entrenched in certain networks. And that becomes a vicious cycle, and this goes on and on. And that's how the whole thing becomes from a simple, harmless tweet to something which is a weaponized platform. So this is to scare you that this is what happens. So what is this? This is a series of hate hashtags, which we collected all the tweets and players over a period of, say, about 3 months. And it includes about 80 hate speech hashtags. We filtered the other hashtags out and we got the top 80 hate speech hashtags. And then we took all the top accounts by the number of retweets they got, and got close to about 75,000 tweets which had these 80 different hate speech hashtags. So this is where social media throws this at you. Now with this network, I don't know how to figure out. So I have to use some of the techniques to come to something more meaningful. So as I start narrowing down to the key players using some of the techniques I mentioned in the beginning, I come to the top 30, 40 people. Now this is the set of top 50 people. And what you see in red is the leader. So this is the anatomy of the organized hate, where one set of people, how they behave. That is the set of people who are the leader in this hate speech. They will give the dog whistle. Now, something very prominent, which due to the size of the slide may not be visible, but now when I reveal it to you, you will notice every arrow is inward pointing to this account, which means everyone else, even though they are in top 50, but they are retweeting this account. So this dog whistle is important enough. This has been registered by almost half of the top 50 people to the extent that they directly retweet this or directly act on this. There is no outward arrow because the leader that way is smart enough to not say it openly or not get involved into this openly. So this is the first set of the structured, organized, which is the leaders. The second set is the influencers. So they are the ones who will spin it. They are the ones who will amplify it. They are the ones who will add context to it. They are the ones who will kind of add memes, images, or get the message to be what the leader wanted it to be. There could be offline coordination. There are fact checker sites who have revealed how the offline coordination happens to coordinate these kind of things between leaders and influencers. So that is, we don't know as researchers, but we know what we see. So what we see is that the influencers have very interesting patterns. So what you see now in red color is one influencer who is one of the topmost influencers and almost connected to everyone. So almost connected to two-thirds of the network. And what this influencer is doing is half the people, the influencer is retweeting and half the people are retweeting the influencer. So it is a kind of very important connect because it has amplification, because it has the ability to spin. They are able to spin it. They are able to generate content, and also they are able to amplify content, which means they have good amount of fan base and they have good amount of creativity to do both. So this is where they have thick arrows with others. They have high number of followers. They may not be obscenely high followers in millions, but they have significantly high number of followers, which is where they have their key number of, they have key position in the top 50. So this is the influencer part. The third one is again very interesting to note. Now this is the amplifier. Amplifier is also embedded in the top 50. But the unique thing you notice here is not a single incoming arrow. Almost every arrow or each arrow is going outward. So what does the amplifier do? Amplifier is only reflecting everything, only retweeting everything, has a good number of followers, can generate heavy volume, because if you keep retweeting a lot, you generate a lot of say interaction or activity and you gather a lot of volume, but no originality. And how you get centrality? You get centrality because of the phenomenon known as reciprocity. If you retweet somebody, they will also retweet you. They'll thank you for that and things like that. So because of reciprocity, they get their amplifier, gets their position in the network or power in the network or the reason to spend all day, because they get to this top layer purely because of amplification without getting into any generation of content. And then the fourth category, which is what I call the useful idiots. So these are the fringe wannabes who are only retweeting or who are just, sometimes they generate odd tweets, which the leaders or the influencers, they want to kind of retweet to keep them in good humor, keep them as fans. But these are all the wide network who are the fringe wannabes who also someday want to graduate to influencers or who have their own reasons to identify with the ideology. So that is the anatomy or the structural machinery of hate, which includes this leader, influencer, amplifier, and the useful idiots. How it plays out, the dog whistle at the center, and that reveals, that generates a lot of activity, because that dog whistle at the center leads to a lot of anger and denial and hate, and even some people will report it. So I just picked up one tweet from today and just reworded some of this content on the right, and This is what is being discussed on Twitter today since morning, that someone says, I have liberty and right to do so and so, I'll buy whatever, I have freedom. It has nothing to do with religion. Now, this is a dog whistle. It has to do with religion, which when you get to the comments, you will get to know. But the dog whistle from the leader gets away. Nothing to do with religion, and I'll do what I want. I have freedom. I have this. Then somebody in the amplifiers and in the influencer, they start adding to this original one. On the right, when you see the second tweet, so where is this calling for social boycott of so-and-so? So-and-so just said this and not this. This tweet doesn't mean this. Where does it say this? And the influencer will also answer, why are you not naming? No, I don't want to be reported to Twitter. So the dog whistle is being given by the person who knows that if they go vocal, then they'll get reported. So the people are asking, why don't you directly name? No, I won't name directly because of this. So then somebody says, no, this is hate speech. We can understand you are being disingenuous, blah, blah. So this, I think everyone is seeing this daily. And this is the anatomy of hate. And this is the anatomy of hate at each individual viral tweet level or the hashtag level or this. So this is where, when I collected this data from today's tweet itself, within last, say, 10, 11 hours, this I collected during the day, I analyzed. So there is these N number of replies, I got 750 replies, 10,000 retweets. This is a huge kind of popular viral tweet, which is a hate tweet, but it is a dog whistle. You can't report it. You can't do anything. And I took a sample of 4,000 by about midday and then analyzed them. So there is a lot of responses which you see in the middle. I just reworded and compressed them. So there is, I agree 100%, agreed, this, that, which I can use AI to kind of filter these, and which is what I built the algorithm to give me how many of these tweets contain religion and how many contain agreement with the original person, how many talk of othering us versus them kind of thing, and how many people oppose it, that no, this is hate speech and we'll not agree and we don't agree to this kind of thing. So these figures, 20, 29, they indicate if I do it manually or if I do it in a algorithm way. The manual thing is more accurate by about 9-10% at this level. I just took a random sample of say 100 and then tried to see how much of the accuracy is built in. And the reason for that is also obvious, because people will use so many indirect references to religion or hate that it is very difficult to be precise. So I'll just stop here. I had to rush towards the end in the interest of time. But I'm open to questions, and that is all that I had to share for the day.
Okay, thank you so much, Sandeep. Lots of compliments over on YouTube in the comments. But one really important question, I think, and a great question to kind of take us kind of forward based on what you've been discussing, is that, you know, what is it that we can do about opacity and, you know, as you said, computational propaganda, etc. Like, what can we do in terms of shifting policy, for example? Is there any way to push platforms towards more regulation, towards more accountability? Kind of, what are there ways in which we can use the kind of evidentiary work that you've been doing to kind of leverage that in order to maybe make changes or push for changes in regulation?
So to be fair, there are already a lot of policy advocacy groups. There are a lot of presentations made by these groups. We have Center for Internet Freedom. There are other, say, research agencies, social NGOs, and other bodies which are dedicated to particular causes related to privacy, surveillance, and they are engaging with the government. But as I covered in the research also, and there are 70 countries with, say, that kind of machinery. And there are also countries with authoritarian regimes who are not interested to engage. And on the part of platforms, if the government and the civil society, they both come on same side. So on certain issues, the government is also a victim of hate speech. So like in the pandemic, even they became victim of misinformation and disinformation. No, don't wear mask or wear mask or this. So that, and or targeting a community, those things then hurt the government also. But the moment this alignment happens, right now, if the government or the regulatory bodies, they themselves show disinterest to engage with the policy advocacy groups, it becomes difficult, because then you have to overcome this additional resistance. And so researchers contribute by arming these advocacy groups, because then they have the backing of, say, the statistical robustness, and they are not talking just based on hearsay or observation. They are robust in their claims, and then someone has to engage. I mean, as we said about spillover, and that engagement, all stakeholders. And so we have seen, like, for example, I can recall from the pre-election monitoring of social media before 2019 social media, there were policy representations on how it can be controlled and how it has to be reined in. But eventually, Election Commission pushed it so close that the only thing they decided was to have self-regulation. Now, self-regulation is an oxymoron. It doesn't happen with the platform regulating themselves. It did not really yield much results. And again, I have enough evidence from the 2019 election also to suggest that there was no regulation. There was no control on hate speech during the period.
Many people have asked whether your slides will be available after this, and which publications talk about this research that you've done, whether that's available.
So both the research papers are under publication, one or under research. One is already submitted, but we have to wait for the reviewers' comments. And then, so that's where most of the content I have to block out the identities, names, or even otherwise I have to block out because of the confidentiality. But right now, so I come from the scholarly side of the information science, where we deal with the information diffusion, propagation, and the research of Aral and Vasavi that I shared in the beginning, where the research, the information goes deeper, wider, and that part. So I don't have social this thing, but yes, unless I take a context, so only. So to answer the question, so far, both are not published. One is under publication, the other is under finalization. The slides will be available, but with some bit of truncation. And you're most welcome to connect with me in case you have certain joint research proposals, or you come from a discipline which has a synergy with the kind of work I do and the tools I use. So we can discuss that.
Hey, thank you so much. I think it's been a fascinating conversation, and there's a lot of interest and engagement on both YouTube and so thank you so much for your time, Sandeep. If there are more questions, we will pass them on to you, and hopefully you can get to them and answer them later. So yes, thank you everyone for, just worth mentioning that Sandeep himself is not on social media, probably very wisely.
So that was my last slide, where if you recall, that was the slide from Cal Newport. He has given a TED talk saying, quit social media. And I found it very kind of convincing. So that's why I share this link. So the title is Quit Social Media, and you listen to this talk. And it is only recently that I quit. It allows me to focus. It allows me to focus on deep research. So, if I have to do good research, the problem is social media is very distracting, and it consumes disproportionate time. So, I do have anonymous accounts to just kind of keep track because of the research interest, but I am not a social media person. And there are many researchers in my area who do that, who are, including Cal Newport himself. He's a tech evangelist who has written a very good book on deep work. So, yes.
I think it helps you to be more objective about it as well.
Yes, even that is there, because I don't have to take sides, but I report what I observe.
Okay, thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. If you enjoyed today's talk, next week there's a conversation again hosted by Das and Hasik by Vivij Joshi on speech in India. No?
No.
Sorry. It's on the 25th.
It's on the 25th.
It's on the 25th of May. If you go to hasgeek.com/das, T-H-U-S, you'll be able to find out more information about that talk. And then in a week, is another conversation between Prateek Sinha, Sandeep again, and Denny George. Prateek, of course, is the co-founder of Alt News. And Denny is the co-founder of Tattle, which is a civic technologies platform that aggregates fake news. And so they will be in conversation with Prithviraj Mukherjee. And that's Monday, 18th May, from 5:30 onwards, a different time. So yes, please join us for those conversations, and thank you very much.
Thank you. It was very nice. Thank you.